I'm trying to do my best today to move from the screen-centered to room-centered. Because there was a few questions just 2 minutes ago that I think they are great to do this moment. It's time for doing so. So my job now will be somehow to look at you and ask you, make you think about what is my role in all this, right? So of course, the proposal of today will be trying to understand how emotional intelligence plays a role in leadership. That's one of my objectives. And I will try as well to see from neuroscience if this we get some answers that will clarify a little bit more. But the main objective would be that you ask the right questions about all these things. Okay? Let me start with a real story. This is something that happened about 20, 25 years ago. I was working and living in Asia, mainly in China. I was in charge of a trade and investment institute, and we were dealing with the investments of some factories, European companies, settled down in China. There were so many different cases, so many possibilities. You cannot imagine the 90s in China. There was no internet at that time. So, well, that's another world that we know today. But there were so few things that really I could compare. Those investments, those projects, sometimes were very similar, one to another. Same type of company, could be different sectors, but same size, same type of people, same amount of money for that investment, even the same geographic and investment area. They were just 1 kilometer away, one from the other one. And you know what? The result was completely different. And by that time, I was still very much on my engineering process. What's going on here? I don't understand. Same, I look at this, I look at there, 1 kilometer. They were making millions. They were making nothing. Just to say one way, making less than nothing. So what's going on? And well, it has to be something happening, right? So I was keep thinking on this, keep observing a lot, and it came little by little this question to me. Is there any factor? Is there anything that makes both projects so different? What's going on? And I start to think a little bit more, and maybe I start to feel that was about human, a kind of human factor. Wow, human factor. I never heard that in the university before. So I started studying, investigating, and of course, talking about this with the owners, with those founders, with those people that were right there. I spent 1 week with one guy, another week with another CEO, another week with another one. So I said, oh, they do the same, but they are not producing the same. So this question was there, and it's already 25 years now. So on one hand today, I'll be talking about my experience. So as we said, I'm not going to judge, but I'm going to explain my experience in all these things about transforming from unconscious to conscious, from uprising leaders, I like to say like this. And on the other side, on the other hand, I will try to bring some insights from science, neuroscience, why not? I'm some details that I'm impressed about it. Of course, that will be a rough approximation because I'm not a scientist, but I enjoy a lot few of them. So I choose a few for you. But remember, the objective is that you are the one. It's not me, it's not the screen, it's not happening outside. Look how comfortable we are here. Well, this guy's telling all these things. It's happening outside, far away. What about me? Where is my role? What is my responsibility? First of all, let me place a question. Do you think emotional intelligence is the same as cognitive intelligence? EQ, is it distinct from IQ? What do you think? The answer is yes, it is distinct. It is different. Scientists, on the other hand, scientists study, they say you need a specific brain area to identify that function, then you got it, that's a special function you can separate. So it happens to be that emotional intelligence has specific brain areas for itself. So it does exist. So we already have, all of you have, by birth, emotional intelligence. Now I'm talking about you, all of you. Right? You agree with that? So let's have a look to this screen. And I go. It's behind me, right? But it's a mirror for you. OK? So I'm going to operate the other way around. Sorry if I make a mistake, but I will try to concentrate on that. So this is the right-hand side. This is the left-hand side for you. All is for you. I'm nobody here, just the one talking. All right? So the left-hand side of your brain will be that one here. Right? Can you touch it? Just the right. Right hand, right. No, no. This is a mirror. Mirroring me, please. All of you, mirroring me. A mirai. All right? Touch it. This is, Raska. Okay. Now, the left hand side. You got it? All right. That's it. More kinesthetically. That feels better, right? Talking about emotions, we need to move forward. Then we'll do another thing. We're going to make this room a collective brain. Somehow Georgina to the left. That would be the left brain. From Jordi to the right, that took me 3 weeks to manage that. I was practicing. That's the only thing I've been practicing before. To my right, right, is your right brain. Right? You know that. All right. The right brain, that's the one. For those of you that know about computers, the right brain works like a parallel processor. And those to the right as a serial processor. To the left, the left. One time. Okay, let's go a bit farther. It's still a mirroring you. The right is everything about present. It's about pictures. That one is about language. This is all about present. Now, right now, right here. And this one is about, oh, the past, my future, oh, everything. It's all the time we're thinking about this. This is very structured, lineal like this. The neurons here are like, rah, 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 rah. The neurons here are like, all mixed around. There are many more connections around, random connections. My mom would be living somewhere here. That's my tip for memorizing that. My dad would be living there, to be honest. They've been, the whole life, they've been like left and right. All right, just skip that. This is a picture, just an ultra simplified picture of your brain. You brain. All right? Now it's you. This is just mirroring you. And you will see the prefrontal cortex. That's the frontal area. Right and left. And the amygdala, right and left. And the insula. These are the most important parts for emotional intelligence. They play a very specific role. And it's not on the left or on the right. It's using the whole brain or specific regions distributed around our brain. There are three situations I want to stress, I want to present as from the, my practice that emotional intelligence is so important. You will recognize when it takes decision making, collaboration, and stress. This is by experience very emotionally demanding. Decision making, it's all about, I tell you an experience about my experience about those directors. The way they take decisions. They, of course, most of them, top guys, they think a lot. They think a lot. They got a lot of information. And then they compare that rational with a gut feeling. Whoa, they do all this process. And then they take another decision. Well, maybe, is that ethics? This is pretty much my experience. And I was surprised with, as I said before, being with one, being with the other. It's always the same, very emotional. Let's see what science is telling. Yeah, I'll take a case which is documented. It's not only one, but one case I was quite impressed is that a guy from a multinational, it's an executive corporate controller. He got an operation because of a tumor, brain tumor, and they needed to take just the tumor off. And in that operation went well, but something happened during the operation that they need to cut the highway between the insula, the amygdala, and the prefrontal left cortex. You know what happened? That guy was extremely brilliant before the operation. He was 160 IQ. After the operation, he was 160 IQ. But he failed completing his business. Zero. Terrific. Why? Because he could not take any decisions anymore. He couldn't take decisions. If you cut this highway, this circuitry, this brain circuitry, you are no longer capable to take decisions. So we need the emotional to take decisions. Collaboration, we could talk a lot about collaborations, but I will share with you something from my practical experience these years. Most of those CEOs that we are pointing at, and I want to transfer the screen to you, all of you, all of them, they were operating in just making things very simple in two possible ways, but can do both at the same time. One is starting with the small things. I'll just say the small things, which very much link to me. Everything is me. Me first. I. This is one way to operate. This is a kind of consciousness. I'm first. Then comes something else, and then maybe one day I get the bigger. But there's another way of operating, starting with the big thing, the we. My colleagues, they've been talking about this. The we first. Erica mentioned that twice. This is pretty much ecological. So I realized by experience that these guys, they either operate under a 3-to-1 attitude or 1-2-3. There's no other possibility. And this same applies to you, to me, to you. You can't do both at the same time. Are you a me operating? Are you me first, or are you we first? The system, all of us, the common good. We can put 100 names here. And this is not about outside. It's happening every moment in every company, in every house, in every family, in every single thing we do, every small thing. So consciousness is not that big thing happening outside there. It's happening in you, you, every moment, everywhere. That's my experience, by the way. Let's see if we can get, okay, John, don't push me so much. I'm the last one, it's about 2 hours to go. I got another instruction from the university. Well, you could extend a little bit. No lines. Let me ask this question. I will extend just a little bit more. Yeah. What collaboration needs? What do you think really needs collaboration? I go for the simple things. You know, I'm trying not to be too sophisticated. Eh? Empathy. Are you right? It's empathy. And there are three, the very interesting thing, I will share with you some interesting points. There's some studies that say that there are three types of empathy. It's my experience, but I was very happy to know that it's well recognized in three different types. The cognitive empathy. It's me, I understand you. I understand your perspective. I get close, but I'm still like this. Second way of empathy, it's the emotional one. It's I'm feeling you. I'm feeling you. That's that. There's another one. Which one? They call it an empathic concern. When it comes to touchy-feely things, the scientists, they start to inventing strange names. But this is the official name they use. The empathic concern. That's when I thinking, I'm noticing that you need help, and I spontaneously want to help right away. This, it's another feeling. Could you feel that for a while? This is giving a clue of the conclusions or the direction I want to present today. Just try to feel it. Mirror neurons, it's a story, unbelievable story that you most probably have heard about it. And we are full of them, and it's like a Wi-Fi system that helps us to interact. We are full of them. And this is something that it's operating all the time, but we can somehow activate it. We have to be concerned about this, and not everyone is using it for the same purpose. There's one thing I want to say. This is the circuitry. To feel the other ones is the same brain circuitry that we use and we need for the self-management, for the self-consciousness. So we need the other one to understand us. This is not by my experience, this is what scientists say. I'm trying to just make it simple. So we need the other one just to understand ourselves. So the other one, it's not a third party. It's very close. It's almost attached to neuron attached, Wi-Fi neurons attached. There's a force. Okay, we would agree that there are some there are many situations that bring stress at work. So this is a discussion we are not going to take. But we would agree But, and we also would agree, I guess that's by my experience, but also your experience, that these situations are not the same for everybody. Same kind of external or same kind of pressure is producing different results. So why? This is another question. So there's some studies called, by a guy called Davidson. They went through a very interesting science study where they took the prefrontal cortex, your prefrontal cortex, and they studied the ratio, the operation ratio between the left prefrontal cortex and the right prefrontal cortex. Just by knowing that this ratio, left to right prefrontal cortex, I can know your mood today and probably the next few days. This is objective. I'm impressed. And they can predict not only this, but the way, what do they call it? Different brain styles, different leadership styles. So how quick I recover from, how quickly I get upset, how fast I'm recovering, even the depth of feeling, the depth of your feelings, it's happening in your brain, apparently. Still objective. I wouldn't go for lines before giving some kind of solutions, right? Wouldn't you? So let's see what we can do to reduce this stress, which is doing such a harm in the new organizations, in the living organizations, making them sometimes almost dead. First thing is do nothing. Walk your dog, take a hot shower, play tennis, do it. You see, I'm making really simple presentation. I could talk about lots of business matters, a strategy. No, let's make it simple. First thing, walk your dog, if you have one. Treat it nicely, if possible. This more. Yeah, it's quite, it's very fashionable. Meditation, we all meditate, many of them. Mindfulness, there's a lot of it. I would recommend some, I wouldn't recommend others. That's another story. I prefer to focus on the third one. The practice, another strange word from science. It's not mine. Just trying to make the both things close. The practice of loving kindness. I said it took me half an hour to, what does it mean? But yes, I realized that it had to do very much with the attitude 3-to-1. Do you remember? So this is a second clue for that factor. The practice of loving kindness. You know what they say these studies? They add, at the end of mindfulness, they add a while of loving thoughts. And they multiply the effect of recovery just by adding a loving thought. What's that? It's new. It's a new paradigm. Oh, just like this. I spend quite a few days a year, even a month, with my clients in the nature, walking, talking, sharing, and doing work, but also talking in a very trustful way. So I'm not going to say nothing detailed, but I want to focus with some data from my experience. I can gather together and produce something. And what they complain about, those top guys and not so top guys, because I tell you, it's the same for all of us. So back from the screen to this room and to your head and to your heart, another clue. So you know what makes them complain? There's another study for a person called Swartz, Tony Swartz. The way we are working is, he's got a very good book. The way we are working, it doesn't work. I like it very much. And he realized, after a study, they realized that there is an emotional trigger for all of these guys they study, CEOs, leaders, but it happens to be that it's also it's an emotional trigger, you can see that, for all of you as well. So this is for you as well. All of us here in this room can, we are, trigger means bam, we have our emotions explode, you will see why and where, when we are, when we are experiencing lack of respect. Some of you here, this is the first trigger. For others, will be being treated unfairly. For others, being unappreciated. For others, will be just not being listened to. Or, I have too much weight, this too much pressure on my deadlines. This for sure one that makes your emotional system explode. Have a look of this, because the leader key factor, just 1 minute to go, it's not far from here. What do you think? What do you think? If I'm the one who is respecting you, I'm the one who's treating you well, I'm the one, I'm listening to you all that, I'm ready to listen to you, I'm really ready to help you, what I'm doing to you? What I'm doing to you? And I need you, because without you, I'm nobody. I'm loving you. I need you. I'm loving you. It's about love. It's about the other one. Remember what my colleague said, what those CEOs said. It's the contrary of the narcissistic, I'm love me. No, I love you. It's the other way around. And it's not happening outside. It's happening in any room, in any office, in any company, all the time. Our amygdala, right amygdala, somewhere over there, will explode and produce an amount, extraordinary amount of cortisol and adrenaline, all your body. You cannot control that. Not even the smartest guy in this room can control that. Your face will get red. Maybe you can dissimulate a little bit, but you cannot control. And that highway from the left amygdala, right amygdala, to the left prefrontal cortex will move to here. And that's the pessimistic one. That's the optimistic, that's the pessimistic area. And the whole thing gets done unconsciously. And then you are not operating in the best way to change the world. So, as some said before, all you need is love. Okay, thank you very much.